Okay.
Of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know.
This is Pamela Kuhn, and the curtain is up on Center Stage, the show about the arts and the artists behind their work. It's that time of year again, folks. Yes, we are talking about movies, music, and Christmas. And I have my old friend, Matt Mickelson, here in the studio today. And I've also got Bob Small, my wonderful engineer, to talk turkey about what binds our favorite Christmas films together. And in line with our recent series of radio shows about the top 10 TV series of all time, we are going to approach Christmas movies this time, but from a slightly different angle. But first, let me introduce filmmaker, actor, and cameraman Matt Mickelson to my audience. Good morning, sir. How are things in the world of Hollywood, New York City, Baltimore, Maryland, and whatnot?
Oh, we're just here enjoying all things Christmassy.
Oh, you sound like Bing Crosby.
He says that in a song right before he gets going.
Does he really?
Yeah.
Oh, I
have
love
it on
it.
A recording. Well, that kind of sounded like Elvis trying to imitate Bing Crosby, but
No, actually you didn't. But it's okay. Whatever you want to think, you go right ahead.
Thank you very much.
It's great to have you again.
Glad to be here.
So last year, we did this great holiday show based on our top Christmas movies that would make a man cry. You know, I don't think we've ever topped that show.
No?
It was
really
excellent.
Yeah, I had fun with it.
Well, it was your idea.
Oh, you know? Yeah, that's right.
And you really got into that. So I think we can't top it, but it was a great subject and we had fun. And let's have fun today, because I really want to talk about the enduring quality of music and music married up with film and even TV. You know, because we're talking about Christmas songs that have had the enduring right to drift from film to film, to television series, to background music, to whatnot. And so we're getting that mixture of, you know, the visual and the oral together. Mm-hmm. And the power, that really wonderful, compelling power that's almost, you know, mythical in a way, bringing us into this holiday season.
Yeah, and I've often wondered, what is it about some of those classic songs from the 1930s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, from Bing Crosby, Nat King Cole, Dean Martin, and Louis Armstrong, Ella Fitzgerald, what makes that stuff stick so well?
That it
never goes out of favor, and it just sweeps you right back, whether it's into the Christmas spirit or the memory of it or the memory of your parents' Christmas or whatever, you know.
What other holiday, though, has its own music?
Not Thanksgiving.
People try because they begin to realize that's where the strength in the Christmas music is that it's connected to the holiday.
Yeah.
Well, we did it with Easter Parade, and that's really kind of it, you know?
Yeah, I know.
I mean, when you think about it, but Christmas is the big topper.
Yeah.
Literally.
Yeah, but there's so many artists that did a lot of work with those songs, and I think maybe, you know, and I was riffing with this with Bob, like maybe we enjoy those songs because they were enjoyed by our parents and our grandparents when they were living the Christmas fantasy back in those days when you didn't have
when they were children.
Yeah. And hearing their stories of, you know, Santa coming down the chimney and how they perpetuated that fantasy onto you when you were growing up, and then how you push that on your kids.
Well, and let's face it, that was an era of hope for this country, you know? I mean, we were in such a good place then.
Yeah.
So this whole feeling of, like, you talk about the fantasy, but it was more than that. It was really about truth and building and being strong. You know, all these things come together.
Well, especially after World War II.
Mm-hmm.
After a long time of, a lot of dark days and the Depression and everything, and then, you know, the late 40s and the 50s happened, and that's when a lot of this stuff came out, especially with Nat King Cole and the gang, and Johnny Mathis, and also, you know, the Vince Guaraldi, Charlie Brown music. You know, I mean, that stuff sticks.
That's right.
And I think it's just because of the orchestrations and the musicality that went into those things, as opposed to some things that that have come out in the past 30 years that don't quite do it just because it's overproduced or it's just too saccharine.
And you just said it. Because, you know, in the Charlie Brown Christmas, there's one point where they do the song Christmas Time Is Here, and it's a little... It's rough recording, and
yeah.
It sounds like a little group of kids, you know, that recorded maybe in somebody's living room. And I love that because
yeah.
It's so real.
Yeah, and the piano just sounds like it's in someone's living room, like it's
exactly.
Not very well put together.
Yeah.
It might be slightly out of tune, you know, and it just gives it that real warmth. And also, I was looking into, you know, when songs started to change in the 50s, from the classic orchestrated Christmas songs like the Burl Ives and Frank Sinatra, and it switched over to Chuck Berry, Elvis, and Bobby Helms, like Jingle Bell Rock.
Right, right.
Or Blue Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right? Yeah,
that's
and
right.
Then also Baby, I'll Be Back, or Bring My Baby Back. That's a Christmas song. My Baby Back, Baby Back. Never mind. That's an Elvis song from 1957. And also Charles Brown did Please Come Home for Christmas. And Paul McCartney in the late 60s, 70s, Paul McCartney and then John Lennon had their own Christmas one-offs.
That's right.
You know, and a lot of other bands had a Christmas one-off, just the one time, like the Waitresses with the Christmas rapping song.
I love that.
That I thought was the Bangles for the longest time, but it's not. And the Kinks with Father Christmas.
Yep.
Give me some money. And the Who had a Christmas song from the movie Tommy. And then apparently Wham had one.
Last Christmas.
That I always forget about until I hear it.
Yeah. Which, until this year, when we have the movie Last Christmas, where again, all of George Michael's music is being immortalized, which I love. I mean, and it's high time, actually.
Yeah.
But the movie is kind of come and gone, but I'm sorry about that, but the music plays on. But what about, you know, like what we just heard, our lead-in was White Christmas.
Yeah.
You know, we're getting back to when music was really written at a time when there was a lot of trouble in the world, you know.
Yeah.
You address World War II, and the men in the trenches knew that, you know, there was a sorry time for them. This song was apparently played in the trenches quite
mm-hmm.
a lot for them.
Yeah.
And what I love about the film White Christmas is that they start with that. So it's real in that way. Yeah. And things like I'll Be Home for Christmas. I mean, oh, my God, what a tearjerker.
Yeah. And if you really listen to the words, I'll Be Home for Christmas.
Yep.
He's not going to be home for Christmas. You know, it's just a fantasy in his own head while he's wallowing in mud in a foxhole getting shot at. It's like, I know I'm not coming home, but I'm just going to, you know, keep this little fantasy that I am in my head, or maybe send you a letter that says, yeah,
it kept them
going. Well, that's the whole idea. You know, nobody wanted to get shot at. They wanted to be home for Christmas where it's warm.
And what is it about this movie, White Christmas, that keeps us watching all the time? You know, for me, I get such a buzz just out of the four leads, first of all. But it's just that fabulous Technicolor.
Mm-hmm.
The reds and the whites just popped, mm-hmm. you know? And then, of course, this goofy story, which is really ridiculous, but it's just so heartwarming and wonderful.
Well, I mean, it comes off as genuine or
yeah.
authentic.
Yeah, yeah, it does.
And that's why you keep going back to those movies. Like, I think maybe the most recent one is 2003 Jon Favreau's Elf,
mm-hmm.
where it kind of felt very authentic, you know, where the message was, you know, be a decent person, you
yeah,
know,
yeah, yeah.
Or even I mentioned last year, 2001's Family Man,
mm-hmm.
where it was like, you know, stop worrying about, you know, being this uber successful person and get back to
what's
basics,
mm-hmm.
what's right in front of you, you know, because a lot of people in that position forget about they have a family and
yeah.
just get so sucked into their job that and then they lose their family because they weren't paying attention to them for the number of years. And it's a great message of just stop, take a second and enjoy, you know, that you're here with,
mm-hmm.
you know, people that love you and you love them and you should just, you know, get out of the rat race and take stock of that before you lose it.
And I love it in Elf because we get a little view of Jon Favreau as
mm-hmm.
a doctor.
Yeah.
Love it because Jon Favreau is now our hero now, isn't
oh,
he, for
yeah.
The Mandalorian?
Yeah.
But we won't go there yet. Hi, everybody. I'm here with Matt Mickelson, our filmmaker, cameraman, actor, and Bob Small, and we are talking about movies of Christmas and the music that goes with them. You know, we just heard Baby, It's Cold Outside. Do you know what that was originally written for, guys?
No.
Neptune's Daughter.
Bah.
Yeah. Yeah. Esther Williams and Ricardo Montalban. Ricardo Montalban.
Con.
So, but they sang it very well. You know, originally it's been done a million times, and now we have the politically correct version with John Legend. But we're not looking at that one, are we? Oh, let's have more fun. Now, Matt, can we talk about maybe one of the greatest Christmas movies of all time? And it's not White Christmas, it's
Die Hard.
Yes!
In a world.
And why? I mean, we forget that this was all around the Christmas holiday, the big Christmas party.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it takes place during Christmas. That's one thing. But but a lot of people, you know, gravitated, especially a lot of cops and firemen that I know, gravitated towards this movie because, you know, once again, you're dealing with a guy who got wrapped up in his job, has lost his family, and this horrific situation is putting him it's forcing him to think about family. Mm-hmm. And I got to get out of this so I could see my wife or save my wife and see my kids again. Mm-hmm. And then when he is on the horn with the cop that's outside, what's that actor's name?
Frankie Faison, I think.
No.
okay, fine. And there we
Not Carl Weathers. Well, I don't know. They're on the walkie-talkie together, and they're both cops, and they totally know what they're talking about, and they, you know, have a couple of hearts.
And accept each other.
Well, yeah.
Like they're Captain Desmond.
Yeah, there's a mutual admiration.
Yeah, exactly. The brass, you know, thinks he's a problem, and you know, he doesn't see what's going on from his ivory tower that he's trying to stay in. With the glass floor. You know, because they could lose that at any point.
We could have those feet cut in the blood trail.
Exactly.
We just have to have it.
But a lot of people are very adamant, you know, I got to see my Die Hard on Christmas Eve.
Absolutely.
You know? And we have at home, we have a list of movies that we have to watch. You know, we have to watch Elf and Family Vacation and Scrooged. Is always a good one, you know, and it harkens back to the same message. Go see your family and stop being a butthead.
Yeah,
I guess,
exactly. You know? And get off your cell phone for just a minute. Let's
put your cell phone down and say hi to your family.
Bob, what do you think? What are your favorite films and the music?
Well, the White Christmas is still the one.
Yeah.
Which I saw recently, somebody had put together a list of favorite films. I don't know where they got it from, but White Christmas didn't make it. It's a Wonderful Life was in there. None of us would have even mentioned that one.
Bah, humbug.
Do you know what the most used piece is in movies? And this came out in Esquire magazine. Jingle Bells.
Really?
Okay.
Jingle Bells, Silent Night. Boom. There you go. Isn't that something?
By the way, can I throw in something that I missed in the conversation a little while back? We were talking about more recent music. Mm-hmm. Mariah Carey's...
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I wanted to mention
that. Is the most successful song she's ever done.
Yeah.
Is her
yeah.
Christmas mm-hmm. song.
And that was in Love Actually, 2003?
Actually.
Maybe you're right.
Yes, it was.
No. Okay.
Oh, yes, it was. And I've just got to say, we got to bring Love Actually into this because
this is
one...
Yeah, that's a great movie. I love that movie.
This is one of the most popular films of all time because it had a cast of 1,000 great English actors who we all adore.
Well, everybody in England was in it,
yeah,
apparently.
Pretty much. So. Pretty much. And in that same production value way...
Including Mr.
Liam Neeson?
No, Mr. Die Hard. He's in it.
Alan Rickman.
Yes.
That's right. And he plays another kind of baddie. He's going a little tarnished there.
Hello, Mr. Cowboy.
Yippee-ki-yo.
I don't finish that.
But the thing of it is, they took the song and they really made a movie around it because Liam Neeson's little boy,
wants to
kind of get it on with her, and he's so young, and the father is trying to find a way into his son. And it's just brilliant, this connection. But I'm just trying to find or remember who performed it. Olivia Ohlman, I think, was her name. And she was She was phenomenal in it.
Oh, did she actually perform that?
Yes,
or
she
was
did.
Is it just like dubbed? You know?
No. That was her.
Really?
That was her. And she comes from kind of production royalty in in Los Angeles.
Like Zoe?
So, yeah, her family is involved. And she's been since involved with quite a lot. But one of the other things I love about Love Actually is probably maybe my favorite moment is when Hugh Grant, when he's going from door to door as prime minister, and he's trying to find this potential girlfriend of his, he starts to sing Good King Wenceslas. And he has two bodyguards with him. Do you remember this moment?
No.
And he's singing rather poorly, or he's over-trying. And then suddenly one of the bodyguards, who's Welsh, and you know, the Welsh have this tradition of being fine, fine singers, like Bryn Terfel and many, many others, and actors. The bodyguard starts to sing behind him, and there's this gorgeous singing voice, and Hugh Grant just turns around and looks at him. It was the most marvelous moment.
I got to watch that again.
Oh, it's fantastic. It's fantastic. But Love Actually, there's so much hope in that film.
Yeah.
I think that's why it endures right now. You know, there are so many happy endings that kind of tie up together, and I think it's really special.
But once again, it has a similar message of, you know, instead of doing what feels good, do what is right, or
absolutely
do what you feel is right. You know, because the Alan Rickman character could have had all the goodies, and he decided not to go forward with that particular offer, or and he was reminded that, you know, family is the most important thing.
So let's talk about family a little bit in a wonderful film called Meet Me in St. Louis with Judy Garland and many, many others.
Have Is that yourself, Christmas related too?
Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas. That was the movie that gave us the song. Oh. It was a real tearjerker at the moment.
Now, Meet Me in St. Louis, is this the one where she's singing on the
trolley car?
On the trolley car.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which is, I don't know why, but that scene sticks with me.
I know.
Is it the ring, ring, ring goes the trolley?
Ring,
is
ring,
that the...
ring goes the trolley.
Okay. I just remember that from Saturday Night
it's
Live.
It's fantastic. And do you guys know how the Christmas song, Chestnuts Roasting on an Open Fire, came to be?
No.
I love this story. So Mel Torme and Bob Wells wrote this, and they wrote a lot of things together.
Uh-huh.
Mel Torme had gone over on a really hot California day to Wells's home. And it was so warm that Wells had disappeared, but he'd left. He'd jotted down some ideas for a song to cool him down. And it was Chestnuts Roasting on an Open Fire, Jack Frost Nipping at Your Nose. Torme finds him outside, and he says, so what is this? And he goes, oh, I was just trying, you know, by the power of persuasion, to get myself to cool off. And he went, no, we've got a hit song. It took them 35 minutes to write
wow.
it.
Sounds like
35
it wrote
minutes. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And then, you know, Nat King Cole perfected it.
And he did it originally with his Nat King Cole trio. And it was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame, I think, in 1974, finally.
Yeah.
But, you know, his voice. I bow to him. I bow to Nat King Cole.
Mm.
And for what he went through to try and be recognized
as
a singer.
Yeah, yeah.
But my gosh, that the voice, the other beautiful song he did, which is kind of Christmas related, that Nature Boy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are just so many moments with him. And we hear them all the time, as you started the show
stick.
With, in all these movies.
Yeah.
It's always somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Do you realize the list is so long that we could not list everything, every movie or every television series that Nat King Cole has been featured in the background?
Oh, really? Okay.
It's hugely extensive. Hugely. So, okay. Any more movie ideas that bring it with the music, guys?
Well,
quiet, are we?
Well, I'm actually family vacation with the hookah, lucky humaka is how we say.
That was a Bing Crosby tune, too.
So every time I hear that now, I think of the swimming pool scene.
Of course, as
and
one
his,
does with
and
Christy
his
Brinkley.
Idiot cousin on the diving board, you know, ruining his thought process. Usually these songs are that's the place where that song is used as a total juxtaposition for, you know, instead of trying to evoke an emotion, it's this guy's trying to have a moment and it's being ruined, obviously, by his cousin. But usually those songs are used to invoke a time period or an emotion from the audience that's an easy catch, you know. So if you're, you know, you have the beginning shot of the camera tilting down under Stars Hollow and the Gilmore Girls or whatever, and you're going to hear the Nat King Cole song, because it's like, it's snowing, even though we're shooting in a outside lot, in the outside lot of Back to the Future at Universal Studios, and we're just going to throw soap at everybody. It looks like snow. And we're going to play Nat King Cole, so it'll work. It'll be fine. What?
And hey, yeah. You don't need anything else to you. We can all just sit back and listen.
Exactly.
I'm going to bring up a film you guys probably haven't thought about, and that is one of my favorites, which still weirds me out. Gremlins.
Oh, yeah, that movie freaks me out.
Yes, it was winter, okay, and do you hear what I hear in the background? After all the gremlins have totally destroyed this house,
mm-hmm.
I mean, things are still on fire, and all you hear is that song playing over and over and over again, and it's still disturbing.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, here's your Christmas present. Don't get it wet. Well, yeah, we did, and look what happened. So it's chaos.
Also, the Polar Express had some weird music in it too. It had when they made it to the magical Santa Land, they had like a basic Christmas song, like a Bing Crosby, but it was on like slow speed, like the record that it was playing on was mm-hmm. warped or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, believe.
You know, because they were like mm-hmm. in this whole kind of weird fantasy slash landscape where everything was just a little off kilter,
yep,
and everything was a roller coaster ride that they walked into, and you know, it was just kind of like everything was just a little drunk, you know, like mm-hmm. they had too much eggnog in their hot chocolate. I don't know.
Yeah, I think they probably did.
But it was weird. I thought it was a weird thing.
I know everybody has that reaction. And did you both see ever the snowman with the beautiful music of Alid Jones in the background? He was a voice soprano, sang beautifully. And the music is dreamy, and the snowman, the story itself is so touching. And it has the same appeal. The dreaminess just comes right across. You see how music can, you know, better a film?
Yeah, all the time. I mean,
I just love it. I just love it.
And I think we touched on in Home Alone, there's this series on Netflix now, Movies That Made Us, I think it was called.
I think
called.
That's what they call it. Yeah.
And there's four episodes right now, and it's all these movies that we think, you know, went off without a hitch and how they were just an absolute disaster. But Home Alone was one of those movies.
Yep.
And John Hughes in Chicago with his whole gang there. And the movie had been shut down a couple of times, and it was switching. It was a mess. And
Chicago was having its warmest winter ever, so
exactly.
They had no snow.
Oh, no, and they had to bring in all of that snow.
Well,
and
some of it. Some of it was real snow. There was one good snowfall that happened during filming, and they used that. And then they added to it with shaved potatoes.
Mm-hmm. Shaved potatoes.
Shaved potatoes and soap.
As one does.
And apparently the potatoes then started to rot.
Yeah.
And so the smell was poor.
Everything smelled like rotten potatoes.
And
also they got, of course, you know, the amazing John Williams to put his magical touch on there,
which
can, you know, make any movie.
Sparkle?
Yes,
tinkle.
Yes. Star Wars would have been really weird without it. You
can
know.
You imagine Star Wars without John Williams?
No.
I cannot.
If they tried some kind of Logan's Run, you know, synth music, that would have bombed.
They would have had to have brought Richard Strauss back from the dead.
Or something.
You know,
something.
It just wouldn't have worked.
But that was the brilliance of using the orchestral stuff as opposed to the, you know, weird synth stuff that was kind of the flavor of the time.
Personally, I love both Home Alone 1 and 2. And, you know, I never go for those kind of films with the kids, but I adore both those movies. And, of course, Macaulay Culkin is amazing. But just the way they managed to capture that whimsy of, you know, the relationships. And, it's so ridiculous.
Well, and also watching, you know, Joe Pesci get thrown down steps every 5 minutes, you know.
And Daniel Stern.
And Daniel Stern, exactly.
The best. But, you know, what about, we haven't even talked about our golden oldie, The Christmas Story.
Oh, God,
the
yeah.
song from that, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
That's like watching your father's experience growing up.
Yes,
you
it
know,
is.
I mean, if you grew up in the 70s or 80s, that's what your dad was doing in the late 40s, early 50s, getting chased by bullies and, getting stuffed into winter clothes that were so inefficient you had to wear 80,000 layers.
You could not walk.
I had that snowsuit in like 1973, and I was, you know, I was like 3 years old, so I couldn't walk anyway, you know. I couldn't actually, you know, stand. I couldn't fall down because it was so stiff, you know.
You know, one of my favorite films of all time for Christmas, besides White Christmas, is actually The Bishop's Wife. The original with Cary Grant and Loretta Young.
With Cary Grant.
And there we go. There you go. I've got my Cary Grant here. I've got two Cary Grants here, Bob Small and Matt Mickelson. We have run out of time again. But I've loved this show. I have loved this show. We'll do it again. I want everybody out there to have a great Christmas and make your own Christmas listening list. You can do it. Guys, thank you for being on the show. We have loved it. We'll do it again. This is Pamela Kuhn, and the curtain is now down on Center Stage.
I had a little blank spot there for a minute, but
I know.
Yeah, we
sorry to go. And I'm like